How many people don't laugh? If I could borrow a line from the Joker from Batman, why so serious? Some of us live our lives way too seriously. We've got to learn to laugh. We've got to learn to loosen up, because after all, the Bible says a merry heart, a cheerful heart, a cheerful spirit is like good medicine. And some of us are sick, if you will, because we don't take this good medicine. The sad reality is that many people live their lives with a frown upside down. I'm not sure if any of you were aware of this or not, but life can be rather stressful. Is this news to anyone that life can be stressful? Have I informed someone here on today upon something that they didn't know before? Life can be stressful. According to a December 2014 Pew Research Center report, the number one thing that's keeping Americans up at night and worrying is money. A 2014 Harris poll found that 72% of Americans have felt stress at some point in time in their lives about money in the last few months, with 64% of Americans citing money as a significant source of stress. That number goes up to 75% for young adults ages 18 to 35. Now, of course, money isn't the only thing that is stressing Americans out. Here are six other things that Americans most likely are to freak out about at some point in time in their lives these days. Number one is this work. The second one is work. The American Psychological Association, APA, has found that 60% of the population blames work for the reason that they can't feel relaxed. A 2013 work stress survey found that work-related stress is on the rise, with 8 in 10 employed people citing their job as a major source of stress. What that is suggesting, my friends, is some folk just don't like their jobs. And they find their jobs, instead of being rewarding and refreshing and reinvigorating, they find their jobs to be stressful. They dread going to work. They dread getting up and getting dressed and going to this place of employee. If they could find a good enough reason to call in, they will do so. They would rather find something else to do than going to work. They are stressed about their job, stressed about not being advanced, stressed and not being promoted, stressed because they're not getting promotions, and because co-workers are not supportive and are backbiting, or because they're dealing with a cantankerous boss, or because their work is not satisfying and or rewarding. They are stressed. Not only number two's work, number three, family responsibilities. Some people are just overwhelmed by the responsibility of caring for their families. 47% of the American population, family responsibility is a major concern for their stress. Between trying to financially provide for the family and the stress that comes with being a parent, 77% said parenthood was stressing them completely out. Did y'all hear that? 77%. You know those little beautiful babies that you couldn't wait to have? You young girls who start playing with those Barbie dolls and Cabbage Patch dolls and what have you. You couldn't wait to have your own real life Barbie doll, Cabbage Patch doll, and you end up getting your little baby, and baby was cute as long as it was sleeping and start smiling and got going, and All of a sudden, you know, those words were starting to form, and that was so cute because they talked with that little baby language and had that little cute little baby accent. But then all of a sudden, those words became a little bit more definite, and that attitude was a little bit more pronounced, and their behavior was a little bit more defiant. And all of a sudden, now what was so cute is no longer cute anymore. Now you find yourself stressed out. Now, what you thought was a blessing. 47% of the American population says family responsibility is a major area of stress. According to another 2014 study, 35% of single parents and 35% of parents of teens reported family to be the most stressful factors in their lives. It's almost like a button is switched, flipped, when they become teenagers. They become a totally different creature when they become teenagers. All of a sudden, as they are battling and dealing with their own identity and dealing with their own transition from being a little squirt now to a teenager who knows it all, as their body is going through development and as they are struggling with their own insecurities and as now they have their own philosophy of life and they have their reason and rationale and it doesn't always seem to sync with yours. Yeah, that's a very interesting period. We can skip right on past that, Lord, if you don't mind. Teenagers, they know everything now and you know nothing. When they were small children, they came to you for the answers. Now, as young adolescents, they come to you saying you have no answers. Why? Because you're outdated and antiquated. You're old. But interesting thing is, we've been their age. They have yet to be our age. So who should you listen to? Yeah. Family responsibility. I know when you met your boo, you thought it was all good in the hood. He's so fine, she's so fine, she smells so good, he's handsome, he's chiseled, he got a gold tooth, he got it going on. And so you knew this was your match made in heaven. You couldn't wait to run down the aisle. You couldn't wait to get his or her name tatted on your back. But only after saying I do, you realize this ain't the same person that I said I do to. Ah, things have changed now. Because during the courting stage, oh man, couldn't nobody tell me nothing. Amen. You couldn't tell me anything about this person, and all I saw was stars and roses and walks in the park. Now all I see is thunderstorms and thorns and, yeah, This relationship is not what I thought it would be, and it's stressing me out. Trying to manage myself and manage another person, make them happy while I'm making myself happy. This is stressful. So family responsibility happens to be one of the stress factors. But wait a minute, not only family responsibilities, but health concerns. 40% of Americans cite that health concerns is their main source of stress. And these concerns aren't just about personal health issues, but the health of the people around them. In 2014, the Harvard School of Public Health poll found that 43% of Americans are stressed about health issues, with 38% of those people worrying about their own health and 37% worrying about the health of a loved one. The poll also found that people who are in poor health are twice as likely as those without serious ailments to report huge amounts of stress in just the last month, the time this poll was taken. Health issues, So with health issues and family responsibilities and work issues and money issues, far and far less people are smiling. Far less people are laughing. Instead, they're stressing. And they're walking around with the weight of the world on their shoulders. But wait a minute, not just that. Personal relationships. With divorce rates between 40 and 50%, remember this was back in 2014, I would imagine it has increased since then, but 40 to 50% in the United States, individuals are ending up in divorce. It's no wonder that personal relationships are a big cause of stress. Death of a spouse and drama within the friendship dynamic. And loneliness due to the lack of romantic relationships are all reasons why 58% of Americans report relationships are causing them a great deal of stress. This, of course, is according to the APA, the American Psychological Association. Millennials, in particular, take a hit when it comes to how much relationship stress affects their lives. Yes, because in 2013, a Harris poll for the APA found that 59% of millennials felt that the relationships in their lives were the main reason for their high stress level. Wow. Another reason why folk are not laughing and not smiling. Can I give you yet another? The fifth reason is the economy. Although unemployment rates may be lower than they've ever been in a while, that doesn't stop Americans from stressing out about the economy. A 2011 APA study found that 67% of the American population, they stress out about the economy. And then 61% of millennials report that their fair share of concerns are economy related. Another reason why folk are not laughing. Another reason why folk are not smiling. But then poor health. Not to be confused with health concerns, but poor health on its own can cause stress, which is indeed a vicious cycle, since stress can be the cause of poor health. A 2014 study found that 60% of those with high stress levels had poor health, while 45% of those with disabilities and 35% of people suffering from chronic illness said it was their ailments that kept them so stressed. Wow. Sounds like America has some problems. So maybe this helps to explain in part why so many people are walking around with their frowns upside down, or their smiles upside down, should I say. And why people are not laughing, why people are not joyful, and why people's faces are contorted. People are all caught up in knots because they're stressing. Well, I'll stop on my way to heaven and tell someone, stop stressing and start counting your blessings. Because even though things may be bad and things may not be what you hope for them to be, it could be worse.
Amen.
So as we look at Proverbs 17 chapter, here's a prescription that God gives through this this writer, this man of wisdom. He tells us in the 17th chapter and in the 22nd verse, he says, a merry heart does good like medicine. He says, here's a prescription. If you want to deal with the stress, if you want to deal with all the pressures in life, here's one thing you can do, and it happens to be the title of my message, laugh a little. Yeah, that's what we ought to do, laugh a little. Can I share with you some of the benefits of laughing? And then I'll be out of your way. I just want to give you a few benefits of laughing, and hopefully you will take these tips and these tools and you will incorporate them into your lives, and maybe you will feel a little bit better about yourself and feel a little bit better about life, because the Bible says a cheerful heart, a merry heart does good like medicine. Yeah. So number one of the benefits of this medicine, this prescription being administered, is laughing, watch this, is cathartic. It's cathartic. What does that mean? It's a catharsis. What it means is it has a way of making you feel better from the inside out. It helps you to get some things out. It's a catharsis. Amen. And so when you learn to laugh a little, it starts making things that are of discomfort inside, it starts just kind of changing things. You don't believe me? Just a few moments ago when I opened up this sermon, I opened up with me laughing. Opened with me laughing. And immediately, guess what? I started feeling better.
Amen.
And for those of you who were laughing with me, guess what? You started feeling better. I know you did. Because some of you were laughing just as hard as I was laughing. And the harder I laugh, the harder you laugh. Some of you didn't find it to be a laughing matter. Some of you thought it was probably the most inopportune time for someone to be laughing. Why is the preacher laughing? He's supposed to be preaching. But the truth of the matter is, my brothers and my sisters, laughing is right here in the Bible. Laughing is like good medicine to the heart.
Amen.
And in laughing, you get some stuff out. I promise you do. There's been times that I've been down in the dumps, and nothing that anyone else could say to me made me feel any better. Nothing that I did seemed to take away the frustration that was down on the inside when I was stressing over family, stressing over money, stressing over this, stressing over that. Nothing made me feel any better.
No.
But all of a sudden, I started watching the Three Stooges. And every time Moe would poke Larry in the eyes and hit Curly upside the head or punch him in the belly, for some reason in his own distorted way, it made me laugh. Or I'm watching old Tom and Jerry, or I watch America's Funniest Videos, and for some reason watching people do some of the most stupidest things made me laugh. And no one take offense to this, I would just watch certain people that lack rhythm dance. You just watch certain people dance, and I promise you, you start smiling. Some folks just dance and they just do whatever. There's no rhyme and reason to it. They just
dance like nobody's watching.
And it's just the funniest thing, I tell you, funniest thing. But these things I discovered that all of a sudden they would turn things around and my disposition would change. My situation may not have changed, yeah, but my disposition changed.
Yes,
why?
Sir.
Because I laughed a little.
Yes, sir.
So it became a regular routine to watch America's Funniest Videos or to watch the Three Stooges or something along those lines, and I would just laugh, and I realized that it was cathartic. It was like a catharsis. All of a sudden, it started dealing with me on the inside, and it started causing me to feel a little bit lighter, feel a little bit better about life. I remember I had a sad moment when I was thinking about my mother passing away, and for a while there, I could not think about her and not just all of a sudden just break out in tears. And I got tired of that, because sometimes I'd be standing preaching, talking to y'all, and I get to talk, and next thing I'm crying, and folks would be like, well, you don't know what to do. The preacher's crying, I'm just crying, I don't know what to do, I'm crying. But then I start thinking about some memories and some memorable moments.
Yes.
Now, I remember one occasion my mom called us, and we were all on the speakerphone, I believe, I can't remember. And she called, and my children, and I believe Marcia's son, I don't know if he was there or not, but Brandy's children and probably a couple others had gone to Minneapolis for the summer to spend the summer with their grandmama. Mm-hmm. And she couldn't wait to get them. She couldn't wait. Send my baby. We couldn't wait to send them. Here's your baby. And we sent all of them. Every day we get a phone call, they laughing, joking, having a good time, going fishing, all these wonderful things. And then all of a sudden, out of the clear blue, we got a phone call, come and get them. Come and get them, every last one of them. Come and get them right now. Come and get them right now. And we're like, Mama, what's wrong? What's that? She couldn't talk. My mom, when she's got angry and frustrated. It's the funniest thing because she couldn't get her words out. She kept, and then you start laughing, that'll make her even more frustrated. So she, and then I'm really laughing and caring, Mama, what's wrong? What's wrong? Get him. Get him. What's wrong? The head. What's wrong with the heads, Mama? They painted them. All she could get out is they painted them. For whatever reason, the children had gotten into a spray can and start spray can painting each other's head, and they all look like their own versions of Cisco from Dream Hill. And she was frustrated and didn't know what to do. And we laughed and we laughed and we laughed. And so every once in a while, I'll think about that occasion when I'm thinking about my mama, and I'll just start laughing. And all of a sudden, those tears start drying up. Yes, and all of a sudden, that heavy burden goes away and that sadness dissipates. And before you know it, I'm caught up in laughter.
Amen.
When I was once caught up in tears and sadness.
Amen.
Laughing. It's like good medicine to the heart.
Yes, sir.
It changes your disposition. It's a catharsis. Yes, it is. But you know what? There's also some health benefits to laughing. Let me give you just a few. For example, laughing. I said it serves as a catharsis. Here's some of the health benefits of this catharsis. Watch this. Laughing lowers blood pressure. For those of you who are on blood pressure, high blood pressure medicine, you walk around stressing out, you popping these pills because of blood pressure? Well, how about in addition to you popping those pills, why don't you learn to laugh a little?
Come on.
Because people who lower their blood pressure, watch this, even those who start at normal levels will reduce their risk of stroke and heart attack just by laughing a little. Did you hear me when I said that?
Come on.
Just by laughing a little bit, you can reduce the onset of a stroke and the onset of a heart attack just by learning to laugh a little. Go and get you the Sunday, well, I don't know, Sunday's funnies ain't funny. Yeah, they ain't funny. You may cry after reading those horrible jokes, but just go and subscribe to some type of funny publication or Google funny stuff or whatever. And your favorite comedian or whatever, and just start laughing a little. But wait a minute, not only does it lower blood pressure, but it reduces stress hormone levels. Stress hormone levels, watch this. You benefit from reducing the level of stress hormones your body produces because hormone level reduction simultaneously cuts the anxiety and stress impacting your body. Additionally, the reduction of stress hormones in your body may result in higher immune system performance. Just think, laughing along a coworker tells a funny joke can relieve some of the day's stress and help you reap the health benefits of laughter. Sometimes when you're feeling sad and feeling down and you're trying to reduce this stress, just think of a previous funny instance. That's what I did just a few moments ago. I caught up on a couple of funny incidents from my past, and before you know it, I just started laughing. I thought of some things that happened that brought a smile to my face, and putting them all together just brought cheer and joy and happiness. And it helps to reduce not only blood pressure, but it helps reduce stress hormone levels, but it also, watch this, is a fun ab workout. It's a fun ab workout. Those of you trying to lose those bellies, like myself, amen. One of the benefits of laughter is that you can help tone your abs, believe it or not. While you out going to get the ab master and what's those things that end up ruining your organs?
Waist trainers,
what have you. You think it's helping you because it's squeezing you in. It's squeezing you in, all right. And now all of a sudden your organs are all jacked up and they're not where they're supposed to be because you didn't just
rearrange the things.
Right up, it swells the right way. Swells. Squeeze. You mean on in there. And now you walk around. Can't breathe. Things ain't functioning the way they're supposed to be functioning. How about just laughing a little bit? How about just laughing? It says it can help you because when you are laughing, the muscles in your stomach expand and contract, similar to when you're intentionally exercising your abs. So you complain and say, Pastor, I can't do no sit-ups. I can't do them. I've tried them. We just laugh a little bit.
Yeah.
Because it's contracting your abs. Learn to laugh, and you may find out that you lost a few pounds in the mid area.
Amen.
Meanwhile, the muscles you are not using to laugh are getting an opportunity to relax. Add laughter to your ab routine and make getting a toned tummy more enjoyable. Some of you are like me, you need to laugh a whole lot. Amen. We need to do some serious, amen. We need to do some serious laughing. Number four, it improves cardiac health. Laughter is a great cardio workout, especially for those who are incapable of doing other physical activities due to injury and or illness. It gets your heart pumping and burns a similar amount of calories per hour as walking at a slow to a moderate pace. Wow. You may be saving some money at the gym just by laughing a little bit. Some of y'all got gym memberships you ain't used since you signed up. Amen. Just start laughing a little bit, and you may see some results. Laugh your heart into health. Oh, wait a minute. Let me give you just a couple more, and I'll move on. It boosts your T cells. T cells are specialized immune system cells just waiting in your body for activation. So when you laugh, watch this, you activate T cells that immediately begin to help you fight off sickness. So next time you feel a cold coming on, add chuckling to your illness prevention plan. Number six, triggers the release of endorphins. Endorphins. Endorphins are the body's natural painkiller. By laughing, you can release endorphins, which can help ease chronic pain and make you feel good all over. Now, some of y'all may not believe this. Try it. Don't knock it until you try it. There are some benefits. I mean, it's in God's word. He says, merry heart does good like medication. And here you have science backing up, as if we need science to back it up, but we have science backing up the word of God.
Amen.
The seventh and final is it produces a general sense of well-being. For laughter can increase your overall sense of well-being. Doctors have found that people who have a positive outlook on life tend to fight disease better than people who tend to be more negative. So smile, laugh, and live longer. Laugh a little. I've known instances where people have been told they have been diagnosed with a terminal disease and have been given a certain period of time to live. They end up dying within a week. Some of them because of their attitude, their disposition. Then I've known people who have lived on years beyond the time they have been given from the doctors. Really, it's your condition of your mind and your thinking and what have you. My brothers and my sisters, your outlook on life. Sometimes you can laugh and or positively think yourself into good health and or at least extended living.
Amen.
What do you have to lose? Laugh a little. So number one, laughing is a catharsis. It is cathartic. But wait a minute. Secondly, laughing is contagious.
Yes.
It's contagious. I go back to my opening illustration. Once I started laughing, guess what? Some of you started laughing. You had no idea what I was laughing about, but what did you start doing? You started laughing. It's contagious. It's something about seeing someone else laugh that makes you laugh. It's contagious. I was scrolling through, really, which was the inspiration for this message. I was scrolling through Facebook the other day, and there was this video on there, and I think the memes or the caption said, "I bet you can't help but laugh." And I said, "I'm not gonna laugh. I bet you it ain't that funny." And all of a sudden, there was a man who was on a train, and while he was on this train or bus, subway, whatever it was, he just started laughing, and this bus, train, whatever was filled with people. Different races, different ages, all of that. And before you know it, people around him just started laughing. They looked at him laugh, and they listened to him laugh, and before you know it, they started laughing. And I'm sitting there, I'm not impressed, and before you know it, I'm laughing. I asked myself, why am I laughing? I have no idea. idea why he's laughing. I have no idea why they're laughing. But all I know is for some reason watching him laugh made me laugh. Laughing can be contagious. It's contagious. It brings a smile to the face of other people. I remember after watching that and then watching another video, I couldn't help but to post, I love seeing people happy.
Yeah.
Happy people make other people happy.
Amen.
But guess what? On the contrary, on the flip side of that, sad people make other people sad.
Right.
Misery loves company. Misery is always looking for some companions. Hey, I'm miserable. You want to be miserable with me? Come on and hang out. Let's have a jolly, miserable time.
Yeah.
Hanging around other folk just make you feel sad. Have you ever been in a good mood? Ready to tackle the world? You woke up feeling yourself. Feeling yourself. You just couldn't wait to enter into the world and do your thing. And before you know it, somebody with a bad attitude, they can't come up around you, and they got a bad attitude and snotty disposition. And before you know it, your smile is turned upside down. Remove me from negative energy draining folk. Go somewhere with that. I want to be happy. So sometimes you got to surround yourself with other folk that have that same positive energy. Positive energy. I know some folk who, no matter what they go through, they just, you know what? I admit, I'm the pastor. I know I'm supposed to be whatever. I know, so you say and suggest and think. But there's been some days that I've been mad at certain folk. Mm-hmm. I admit, don't look at me strange, because you've been mad at certain folk too.
Come on.
But I've been mad at certain folk, and I don't have anything to do with them. But because they were true to who they are, they remain upbeat, even though I don't have nothing to do with them. I intentionally tried to be mean.
Yeah.
Intentionally tried to be standoffish. Intentionally tried to be short. They'll say something funny, I ain't laughing. They say something to you, I ain't responding. And you just intentional about being whatever. But guess what? They were true to themselves, and they kept on being fun and jovial.
Yes, sir.
And before you know it, you sit there and you just feel like a heel.
Yeah.
My disposition has not affected them whatsoever. They've continued to be happy. Act like ain't nothing wrong and go on. Sometimes that makes you even more mad.
Right.
It makes you even more angry. But when people are true to who they are, I'm not going to let you upset my good day.
Yeah.
I've made a decision, a conscientious decision, to be happy.
Amen.
It's hard sometimes. You got to fight through your own personal emotions. You got to deal with other people and deal with their drama and deal with all that garbage. But you know what? Just be true to who you are, because laughing is contagious. Because I've seen on the flip side of my illustration I just gave you, I've seen on the flip side that when you allow laughter to enter into your life, that even when you're mad at people, sometimes funny things just occur between the two of you. Before you know it, you're laughing your way out of that negative disposition. Sometimes you just look at someone and you just, you know, and even though you're mad, or I mean, you, what's that saying, what's that phrase? You're hot in the fish grease. you're so angry you could spit nails. But all of a sudden something happens, and before you know it, the person you're angry with, you just start laughing. And y'all have laughed your way into good relationship back one with another. Laughing is contagious. Yes, it is. But then thirdly and lastly, laughing is comforting. It's comforting.
Yes,
it is. Because you walk into a room where there is laughter, and there's excitement, and there's joy. And all of a sudden, that contagious joy and excitement begins to change the atmosphere in such a way, or create an atmosphere that when you walk in, it's just comforting. You don't believe me? Okay, let's take this church as an example. We do a pretty good job. Maybe we can do better, but we do a pretty good job of having greeters that at least know how to greet.
Yeah.
Trust me, I say that because I've gone to some churches and the greeters, oh my. The greeters make you really reconsider whether or not you want to walk through the doors of the church. Greeters sometimes don't greet you, they growl. That's not what the readers are supposed to do. But the greeters in our church do a pretty good job. I hope you agree with that. That when you walk in, there's a smile on their face. And there's usually a hug that awaits you, or a handshake, or a high five, or something. Amen. The baby's testifying and agreeing with me. Amen. You walk in, and there's this joy, and it creates an environment that, guess what? You're welcome. Yeah. And it makes it comforting.
Yeah.
But you walk into a place where that's not the case, and you don't feel welcome. It's not as comforting. You walk in and you're a little reserved, and you don't know whether or not you should sit or stand, or where to sit or stand. You just have questions. It's not warm. It's not welcoming. One of the things that I used to really pride our church on is what one of the things I challenged us to do is to find out what's oozing in the community about our church. And you know, one of the things that I heard time and time and time again that was oozing in the community about our church was that you felt welcome. People felt welcome.
Amen.
People felt like the people in the church wanted them in the church. It was friendly. It was kind. That's what I heard time and time again. That's what I wanted to hear. That's not a reason to laugh. You almost tripped. That's not funny. Amen. But that was one of the things that oozed out in the community.
Amen.
So when you walk in, it creates an environment that's comforting. Mm-hmm. My brothers and my sisters, that's what laughing does. That's what laughter does. It has some internal value, and it has some external value as well. It makes you feel good on the inside. It's cathartic. It makes others feel good on the outside because it's contagious and it's comforting. So, having heard that and all the benefits associated with it, laugh a little.
Amen.
Yeah. Laugh a little. Amen. When you go home today, no matter what you face, no matter what you're confronted with, laugh a little. When you go to work tomorrow, go to school, or whatever you got going on during the week, and you deal with folk who getting on your last nerve, laugh a little. Just laugh. Learn to laugh. Your spouse get on your nerve. You know, sometimes you can come from worship on a high and feeling so good. God is awesome and greatly and wonderful and greatly to be praised and all that. And as soon as you get home, boy, I tell you, he or she done just made you feel like, laugh a little. Laugh it off. Shrug it off. And I promise you, the benefits will outweigh the burden. Amen?
Amen.
Laugh a little. If you receive that, give God some praise.